By point of introduction, a very important scripture. Turn in your Bibles, please, to 2 Samuel 23, and I want to read this to you. I want to start off with a few introductory comments and then jump into the meat of what we're going to be doing tonight. Myself and Alexander have the privilege of opening up this first session. But I'd like to read this. These are the words, 2 Samuel 23. These are the last words of David. The inspired utterance of David, son of Jesse. The utterance of the man exalted by the Most High. The man anointed by the God of Jacob. The hero of Israel's sons. And this is what he says. The Spirit of the Lord spoke through me, and his words were on my tongue. The God of Israel spoke. The Rock of Israel said to me, when one rules over people in righteousness, when he rules in the fear of God, he is like the light of morning at sunrise on a cloudless morning, like the brightness after rain that brings grass from the earth. Don't you love that? That when people, men and women, rule in righteousness, rule and lead in the manner in which God has called them to lead, there is life. There is life. How desperately we need leadership like this in our nation, let alone globally right now. How much more do we need righteous, godly leadership in the church, in families, especially in these crucial days, where everything is conspiring to push us backwards, to keep us locked up in a ghetto within our minds. God, in this time, is unearthing incredible leaders during this time. Because post-COVID, let alone during COVID, we are going to need men and women of conviction, of wisdom, of right standing before God, clarity of mind, purity of heart to lead with courage and wisdom in these times. And that's part of the reason why I think certainly I'm so excited to speak about leadership as we go through the next number of weeks looking at leadership matters. A couple of other thoughts as well. Right now, we are deepening our foundations for the sake of fruitfulness going forward. Why are we looking at leadership? I've touched on part of that already in what I said a moment ago, but when all things seem to be in a lull, it's an opportunity for you and I to go deep in God. Winter time, seasonally, is not a time for silence. Trees and plants are doing remarkable things, while at face value, everything seems silent and fast asleep. And right now, it seems like the church has been has pressed pause, and it's in an apparent winter time. I want to say it's completely not a winter time. God is deepening our resolve in the things of the kingdom. He's deepening our foundations for the next push that he wants to bring, not just for Freedom House, but for the church globally. I think we're all sensing that. And in a moment like that, we need to prepare well. We need to think clearly, together with the Spirit, about the things that are really important for us. Nothing more important than raising up a generation of Jesus-like leaders in all of life. And so you've heard us say, this is not just for leaders officially already appointed, as it were, in Freedom House. This is for the entire church, because we are constantly, Dylan Smith, wanting to raise people up to be influential in the sphere of influence that they have their lives in. Whether you like it or not, people are watching us. We are not thermometers. We are thermostats. And I'm not going to go too deep into that analogy, lest I get distracted. But we are thermostats, whether we like it or not. People are watching us. They are taking our cue from our lives. And as Sid and myself and a few others have seen in the church in Tembeni, it is the overflow principle. God is wanting to unlock his limitless resources in the area of leadership and inside of our lives because people are watching and they're looking for a people of overflow. We've just wrapped up today, Sid, the incredible leadership program that we've been doing in Grantville with incredible outcomes. Isn't that true? There's so many stories, men and women being catalyzed to influence their sphere of impact right now. The North Coast needs us. You and I need it. The church needs bold and courageous leaders. And so here we are going deep and we are going to be reframing and redefining what leadership is in Freedom House. Moreover, we need to understand leadership in two regards, a biblical context as well as a contextual understanding. And so what we're going to be doing this afternoon is, first of all, painting a picture of the culture within Freedom House, because you and I are a part of this family. We're a part of, as Benita shared this morning, the people of hope. And if you did not listen to Benita's sermon this morning, I want to encourage you to jump into that. One of her points was God is raising up a people of hope. And you and I get to be drawn into the Freedom House family. And Freedom House has a particular culture under God that we need to understand. That means he hasn't randomly called the Charteris clan from Cape Town for a bizarre reason. No, he's called them from Cape Town to be a part of Freedom House to learn and glean from what God's got within our family. Isn't that true? But our story lands within God's story. And so Alexander, after I bring some of an outline as to who we are and what we're about, we'll begin to frame all of this up in the most important story, God's story, and how leadership looks, yes, in our family, but how does leadership look in God's family? We take our cue from that space. So a very brief overview, and I must say I am so excited by the next number of weeks. Listen, to be fair, we could speak about leadership till the end of the year quite easily. But we are hoping to keep it as short as humanly possible. But the first 5 or 6 weeks looks something like this. Obviously tonight, good evening, Heidi, take a seat. There are a few for you to choose from. Tonight is an introduction to what we are going to be doing. But next week, we are going to be looking at some biblical leadership models. This is going to be very exciting because we're going to begin to delve into the leadership models within Scripture. That's going to be an incredibly instructive process. The next week, Sunday the 26th, is super important because we want to understand leadership by taking a brief overview of the philosophies of leadership that are open to us, and particularly social set theory. Alexander is going to lead off, and we're going to work together in understanding what that is. Let me just back up and say, next week, Greg, myself, and Alexander are going to look at 3 distinct examples in the Scripture. It's going to be absolutely fabulous. And then the weekend thereafter, look at social set theory. Many of us have been on the receiving end, by and large, of poor leadership. And it's left a mark in our lives. And many of us in the church are incredibly jaded when we say the word leadership. We get nervous. Isn't that true? God wants us to understand the biblical view of leadership. But also, there's some beautiful ways of approaching it to contextualize it, to understand. When we get to social set theory, Many years ago in London, I read Alexander's book. I'm happy to boast about my friend if he's not happy to boast about himself. And I read this book called Doing Church. I can't remember much about anything else, but when I got to the chapter of social set theory, something came alive because I had been saved into a particular leadership style. And it made sense to me in one regard, but in most other regards, it didn't really make sense. And I had to change myself, but I began to, by the Spirit, intuitively understand that there had to be a better way of leading with better outcomes. And when Alexander began to write in that book, and it was like he was sitting in front of me, teaching me face to face, it brought incredible hope. And it's been hugely formative for the way that I lead right now. So can't wait for that. 3rd of October, we are particularly focusing on Jesus' model of leadership. Can you see what we're doing? We're starting from a broader perspective and beginning to hone in on some specifics. All right, we're going to have a look at Jesus' model of leadership. And then October 10th and 17th, we are going to look at the 5 C's that are crucial to the call and the outcomes of leadership in our lives. It's going to take 2 weekends to look at that. It's going to be absolutely fabulous. That's the first part. Are you excited? The second part, we will begin to land leadership specifically within Freedom House and have a look at our values. Greg, I can't see your handsome face, my friend. Can't you just move to your right so I can see you? I like to see people's faces, lest they nod off and I can wake them up. I just love to be able to read things. So, here we go. Freedom House. God is wanting to raise up some leaders within Freedom House. And what we want to do tonight, just for a little bit, maybe 15, 20 minutes before I hand over to Alexander, is begin to tell the story of who we are by way of mission and vision. So, won't you please open the things that we send through to you. I want you to work with me. So culture is something that just happens whether we know it or not. If we are not intentional about establishing a culture, culture will be determined from the outside in. The world has a culture. The schools that we went to have culture. The workspaces that we're a part of have a culture. Guess what? Your family, whether you know it or not, has a culture. We at Freedom House want to take culture by the scruff of its neck in every right sense of the phrase and begin to establish a heavenly culture, a biblical Jesus-style culture in our midst. Now, culture has a number of aspects to it, one of which is truth. Secondly, the understanding of truth. Thirdly, a lived out culture or an application of truth. And finally, when we get to impart the truth, that is when we know a culture is really on fire somewhere. When we are living that culture out, not just personally, but we are imparting it to others. So what we're trying to do over the next couple of weeks is begin to paint a revelation of what this culture of leadership looks like in Freedom House. But secondly, we want it to be something that is understood and grasped, whether by Josiah at 13 or anyone else, regardless of age. We look at it and we go, yes, I can prescribe to that leadership culture. But not only do we want you to understand this, Jen Duncan, but we want you to understand it, Dom, and live it out. But live it out in such a bright and wonderful way that you impart it to people around you. That's when culture endures just a single generation and is passed on from generation to generation. Okay, so Freedom House's culture code, if you want to call it that, starts with our mission. Our mission. Who we are and why we ultimately exist at Freedom House. And all of who we are and why we exist, even specifically leadership, lands into this context. If you are to cut me, It is this thing that must come gushing out of me. It is the essence of why I exist. It is the essence of why Freedom House exists. Mission is that long-term thing that we aim for that is enduring until Jesus returns. When Jesus comes back, he's going to arrive and he's going to knock on the door of Freedom House. And it is this that is pulsing in our veins. It is the blood of this house. And let me just paint a simple picture.